Yeah, so speaking of conversations with us, okay, before we were recording here, tell us about your adventure down south, Botchico.
Right, this is very interesting. So, we ended up outside Wigan.
Okay.
And I've never been to Wigan. It's an interesting place. But then, we saw it. Wigan Goths.
Wigan Goths?
They clone south for the winter. And we saw them, and they're like,
what's special about a Wigan Goth?
They're not a Dundonian Goth.
That's true.
They're not a Glaswegian Goth. They're a Wigan Goth.
If they're south, then wouldn't they just be from everywhere? And they're just moving down?
See, it's because,
in my opinion,
Karen, you see, they move in herds. They do move in herds.
A herd of Goths.
Speaking of Goths, what happened to Valak?
Yeah,
I mean,
it's all going quiet on the Valak front.
Why? What's happened to Valak?
Oh, did you not hear?
Yeah, no.
So, remember they had a match at the Dark Dub show?
I wasn't there.
What I know about it, did you not see the promotion for it?
I know, I was on the poster. I couldn't make it.
So, Ken, I'll let you tell the story.
They had a good match.
Yeah.
But usual Redgate shenanigans. They got involved.
They also move in hearts.
They do move in hearts.
They do move in hearts. I know, I got fired because of it.
Sammy put out that usual trick he's been using the red mist. And they just took him.
Yep.
Like,
carried him off.
They just carried him off.
But I didn't know what heard from.
Like, I
just phoned the police.
We tried.
We don't know where they went. We went backstage.
What are the police going to do? Nobody knows where we're
at. They just vanished.
Yeah.
Damn, I'm not a detective anymore, so I can't give you a hand.
No.
Could we see the road? Do we need Detective Botchico to come back on the case?
I would, but the police have. The judge were very clear, I'm not allowed to do that anymore.
Okay, we'll not go into that. Maybe that's for another thing.
Meant to impersonate.
But ladies and gentlemen, welcome back
yes.
to the SCW podcast. I am your host, Patryk Patelski, alongside, I think, after the last episode, what can we can safely say is basically the new co-host now.
Yes.
Because Christ knows what Duke's up to these days.
And he's been on a bad path, it looks like.
With the way he's been acting recently, I'm not sure how much I want to do with him anymore,
yeah.
as much as it pains me, because we were very close friends. We bonded over this podcast here.
Mm-hmm.
Anyone that's been paying attention to SCW will know that he's not the Duke that I knew and loved.
We will discuss that.
But happy days now.
Yes, we'll discuss that later on.
And,
yes.
And we have a guest.
We do have a guest.
An esteemed guest. A man that I've been wanting to get on this podcast since it started.
This is when he was fired.
That's true.
And we've gone back.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, Botchico's here!
Hey! Wait, but you said you've got a guest. Who's a guest?
You're the guest.
Wait, I'm a guest.
Yes.
Oh, I don't know how I feel about this. Yes, I'm a guest.
Yes.
How are you guys?
I'm good.
Good.
How are you? How have you been? How's the injury?
It's been, yeah, November was kind of tough and December was kind of tough. You know, just sitting from the sidelines and, but you know what? It's back.
Good.
Yeah, like, I've got the all clear,
nice.
Back training, back in the gym,
yeah.
and hopefully you'll see me back in SCW as soon as possible.
Good. Because you know what? You came back like a house on fire. You came at the tail end of last year, returned at the Rumble, number 30. I was sitting at commentary beside the commissioner when he finally made the call, thinking about time. Came out, nearly won the whole thing.
Yeah, that's...
Very, very close to becoming the game changer that night.
I was so close, but... Dickie Divers was he was the man on the night, but I think more of the man was Serena Rose, who pulled me off, who grabbed me and made sure I didn't win.
Yeah,
yeah.
And who knows what you could be sitting here SCW champion right now if it wasn't for Serena Rose.
Ifs, buts, maybes, but you know what? I was just happy to be back because.
So were the fans, but
yeah.
I've not heard a reaction in Tulloch like that in forever, I don't think.
Yeah.
So it was really good to see. And then you followed up a month later by taking on your former mentor, Yuji Maki, coming out on top as well.
I know, that's the first time I've actually beaten Ewan.
Yeah.
Like, I've wrestled him several times.
Former champion in his own right as well.
Yeah.
So.
I think you got through to him at the end. I think you broke that barrier for him.
There was something there, like, he kind of teased something out of me, like, and I was just sitting there just looking at him, going, like, this is not the guy who took a chance on me all those years ago.
Sorry, I don't think if it was for Botchico, Ewan Jumaki would not have been sloshing with us in the Queen's Hotel.
No.
And that's.
Wait, you guys sloshed in the Queen's
Hotel?
Yeah.
I missed that.
Oh, the mums loved it,
man. They did.
Oh, man.
Several of them wanted photographs with Big Patryk after the show.
Whatever happened to me, Queen's Hotel? I got fired.
Don't you worry. We've got another show coming up in April, which we'll be back at. And before that, though, we are here to plug the next Fair City Wrestling Empire show coming to you live and in living colour from the Tulloch Institute in Perth on Friday, March the 1st, I believe is the date. It is.
Friday, March the 1st.
And it's not just any show, is it, Kim?
No, it's not.
We've got a March mega deal, baby.
We do indeed. Yeah.
Normally, our tickets are very reasonably priced. So I think it's right about the £12 mark normally, which they will be on the door that night. Mm-hmm. Usual prices will apply. But if you get your tickets in advance at faircitywrestling.com or through
ticketsource.co.uk,
you can get them. Thank you, Kairn. You can get them for £5 sterling.
Yes, indeed.
Same as the Dapper price.
£5
so,
quid.
Yeah.
Thanks, Glenn.
Do
you guys lend me £5 so I can get in?
Oh, I don't want it. No lend. This is your fee. We'll get you a ticket in the
Oh, brilliant.
Yeah.
That's fantastic. Yeah. I get to be on... Oh, no, I don't get to be on the show. I get to see the show.
Yeah, exactly.
What show it's going to be.
Exactly. But before we get into talking about that, because as part of our job here on the podcast, plug the product. And do you know what? Before we even get into Botchico's five questions of doom, a tradition of sorts was started on the last episode by yourself, Kairn Douglas. Brought on a certain hot sauce.
I did indeed. I do kind of regret it, but I had brought it with me.
So yeah, it's back, baby.
It is back.
And so if Kairn and I did it, it's only fair that you do it now as well, Botchico.
I think so. So how many is that Jukes going to have to do after this?
I'm getting to the stage where I don't even care.
I
don't know how much time I want to spend with him after the way he's been treating everyone right now. I need to have an out one at some point.
Yeah. We'll discuss
that. We'll get on to that later.
Let's get this done.
Right. So.
I'm a little bit scared of this, guys. I'm not going to lie.
Well, you know what? We believe in you, Botchico.
I mean, you know what? I've got this, right? So, it's no more scarier than facing the red gate.
No, absolutely not. So some might say that we've moved up in the world. I think Kairn would say that we've moved up in the world, because last month we had sort of like supermarket sort of like tortilla chips, didn't we? We've moved up to rice thins.
Ooh.
Cream and onion flavour, rice snack.
Oh, this is...
Just give them a little bit now.
Yeah.
Then we'll ask plenty.
I think I have to eat it quickly. It's dissolving the cracker.
Yeah, it is.
There you go.
Right.
So you've got a couple of beverages here to help you afterwards. So let's see how you get on.
Right, actually, you know what? I'm going to be a bit insane. I've strictly taken on the red gate. I'm going to flip it upside down so I get the sauce on the tongue.
Oh wow! I like it. There he is. Well, Kairn Douglas is getting some content for the podcast. Yes. I like it. Always thinking.
Mm-hmm.
Up there for thinking.
Doing the dancing.
Yes, baby.
Okay, it's not bad. My face is coming numb now.
Yeah, describe, what does it taste like for the viewers at home, the listeners at home, rather?
It tastes... Oh, God.
There it is!
It ended really well, and now it's just like... Yeah, I tried to swallow it. It's like... I, you know what, I put that on the level of it. It's like the same as when Tom Atlas ran in and kneed me in the face.
I've experienced that as well, it's not fun.
At least after that, got to DDT him. I don't get DDT that sauce. Can I DDT the sauce, actually?
Maybe later.
Don't touch your eyes.
Please don't touch your eyes.
Oh, God, I touched my eyes!
Touch your drink. That was a good one.
God, it feels like my eyes have gonorrhea.
I can see the steam coming through your mask.
So, for the listeners at home that might have not listened to the FW podcast before, I'll tell you how it works. We have a guest on every month.
We do.
We like to educate our listeners at home a little bit more about our guest. And so we asked them the FCW podcast five questions of doom. We'll go through them. I'll ask one, you ask one.
Yeah.
I'll ask the first one. Botchico, you're being trapped on a desert island.
Yeah.
Okay. Not really, it's fine. You're in Patrick's house and everything's grand. It's just the hot sauce you need to worry about. But hypothetical desert island, okay?
Okay.
All you have to entertain you is one wrestling show. Pay-per-view, live event, episode, a weekly show, whatever you want, but you only have one show to watch for the rest of your time trapped on this island. Which wrestling show would you pick and why?
That's a really good question. So do I get to watch it with the Shark and the Zodiac?
Whatever you want, but you can have.
Well, you said it was the Dungeon of Doom I have to watch it with, right?
And if you want, yeah.
No, you said five questions of Dungeon of Doom.
Yes, I did, yes. You're right. You got me.
Oh.
I'm surprised nobody else has picked up on that.
But surely we could choose the Shark to swim away. Like, he could get the...
He's a thinker, isn't he?
What?
I like it. He's like life hacked this podcast.
What?
conclusion that John Tent and the Shark can't swim away. Right, the pay-per-view I would pick. There's no Hulkamaniacs here.
There is no Hulkamaniacs.
There's only Pasta Maniacs.
That was a fantastic place. Did you know he almost had the George Foreman grill?
Really? Did you know that Ken Douglas' favourite pasta is rigatoni?
Really?
Fun fact. Jonathan Gresham's as well.
Yes.
Oh. But anyway, back to the podcast.
Sorry. I'm getting sidetracked.
So what would
I'd be the shark.
Fucking shark.
Stop man. Going on about it.
What would your wrestling show be of choice to watch for the rest of your time?
Heroes of Wrestling.
Heroes of Wrestling. Right. For
the greatest wrestling show of all time.
For the uninitiated, please tell us all why you'd be picking this.
I was going to say, Jake Snake gave the greatest promo of all time on that show.
We all play 21, I believe that was that one. Yeah.
What would be better than that?
I'm just looking up the card now to remind myself.
Like Tully Blanchard wrestled on the card. Yeah. We had Yokozuna. We were all in their prime at that point.
Did we have the proper Yokozuna, or did we have the greatest Royal Rumble Yokozuna?
What are you talking about? Was that not Yokozuna at the greatest Royal
Rumble? Oh, yeah, sorry. Yeah, I'm talking rubbish.
And then the other had Marty Jannetty on the show.
Yeah, like Marty Jannetty was best, great. The Hammer Valentine was great. Yeah. What?
Tickles Spikers was on it.
Randy's brother.
Yes, Randy's brother.
Yeah.
We had Nikolai Volkov, and we've got a tag team in a bit instead of a singles match.
Oh, the Samoan Swap team. They were on there. Like, yeah. Paul Heyman's boys.
Yeah, and Jim the Anvil Neidhart, one of the Hart Foundation.
What a show.
It was such a great show.
I don't know why this got such a bad rap.
Yeah.
What a five.
Why are you...
Jimmy Snickers on it.
After the podcast, we'll tell you why Jimmy Snuka is maybe not the best person in the world.
Yes. Is it because he lost to The Undertaker the first time?
Yes, exactly. Because then if he...
Is that the Bushwhackers that was on it, isn't it?
Oh, yeah. What else was on there?
The Iron Sheik.
One Man Gang.
Oh, they had Abdullah the Butcher as well.
Also not the nicest person in the world.
Yeah.
Back to the Bushwhackers. Did you prefer Butcher or Luke?
Definitely Luke.
Luke? Yeah. Why? What made you a Luke man?
I don't know.
I feel like
he lasted longer in the Royal Rumble than Butch.
I also didn't know Pete Dunne was in the Bushwhackers.
Everyone knows he was in the Bushwhackers. Why didn't he know that? As I say, it's common knowledge. He was, as you say, you know, he was like, you know, running around giving it all this, and then, you know, he's like, I'm fed up. Being in the WWF in the 1990s, I think I'm going to be reborn and call myself Pete Dunne and live in Birmingham.
Yeah.
Everyone knows about that.
The method acting, he moved to New Zealand.
Yeah, and then
reincarnated himself in Birmingham.
Why do you think he wasn't a big fan of Gunter, that Eastern Wall man? He still had that Cold War mentality.
We'll be back next week with more Botchico facts.
A whopping 2,300 people are in attendance for Heroes of Wrestling.
No, a buy rate of 29th.
Though. There you go. Are we on the same Wikipedia page?
Wait. Heroes of Wrestling had 2,000 people there. That's like...
2,300.
2,300. Like, that's like Mania levels, right?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, like, you know...
Mania... Not even Mania 1. Mania 1 was probably more than that. It was Mania 1.
I was going to say, there was only, what?
Arva Mania levels.
There was only, 1,000 people at WrestleMania 1, right? I counted them myself.
Yeah. Were you there?
I refuse to answer that. It's a personal question for age.
I would never want to insult you like that, Botchico.
But if I can get Heroes of Wrestling, I suppose...
Yeah, honorary mention. Give us an honorary
mention. If I can get Heroes of Wrestling, I suppose it's Survivor Series 2002. You have to go for the lesser card.
The attendance for Mania 1 was 19,121 people. So I was a bit off. We were a bit off with that there. But,
again, reminding myself... Was this the original Elimination
Chamber? This was the original Elimination Chamber. Yes. I can actually tell you the card off by heart.
Right, go for it. Right, hang on.
Right,
I've got it up, so I'll finish it out. Yeah.
I will try this from off by heart. So, the opening match was a tag team tables match between Spike and Bubba Ray Dudley, the only iteration of those Dudley
guys,
tagging with Jeff Hardy against 3 Minute Warning and Rico.
I love the 3 Minute Warning, man. That was great.
Okay, like I say, respect.
Rosie. Yeah.
The original tribal chief.
Jamal's gone as well now. They're both up in the sky, unfortunately.
Excuse me, Jamal, do you mean Umaga?
Yes.
Umanga! Umaga!
In a past life, it was Jamal.
Then, I believe, interesting story at the end of that match, Devon Dudley returned to reform the Dudley Boys.
Oh, was that them getting back together?
Yeah, with Reverend Devon.
Yeah.
You know what, I actually...
Oh, yeah, when you introduced Batista to the world.
I donated to their church, but I never heard anything back.
Oh, you like Reverend Botchico? Why did that never pop up like last year?
I tried to join, but apparently there's a bit of a funny thing when you say, well, I'm not allowed to keep the collection box.
Mm.
I have read the paper.
I feel like this could be on like a Netflix documentary at some point.
Mm. Like, yeah,
you got conned by the Church of Devon.
Yeah, I know. Like I was gonna start my own. I was gonna start my own chapter. I'd phoned Randy Valentine. I wanted to be Reverend Randy Valentine.
Randy Valentine. Yeah.
I like Randy wouldn't take my calls for some reason.
Come on, Randy. You got to do better than that.
I know. Like he hadn't answered my other 100 calls where I was saying he should be Rebel Randy Valentine. Hey, retired Randy Valentine.
Well, he was.
Revolutionary Randy Valentine. I was going to get my Chairman Mao outfit and everything.
Love it, right. What, right, come on, mate. Let's go right, for okay, so we're going after that.
So I believe after that we had Billy Kidman versus Jamie Noble for the Cruiserweight title.
Yeah.
That was another great match because Billy Kidman was actually a hero of mine as a kid.
Two very good wrestlers. I'm a fan of both of them, Billy Kidman and Jamie Noble.
What?
That's wrong, Billy.
Oh, wrong, Billy.
Yeah,
wrong Billy. That's my dislikes. I'm kicking out.
I don't joke about Billy Kidman. The originator of the Shooting Star Press. But yeah, no, like I'll give you a little fact finding thing here. Yeah. Very first wrestling match I ever watched: Billy Kidman versus Ivertu Guerrero, Nitro for the Cruiserweight title, and that hooked me on wrestling.
No wonder.
And I actually got to see Billy Kidman wrestle in person once.
Class.
But anyway, I'm getting off target. I believe the next match after that was Trish Stratus versus Victoria in a hardcore match.
Do it in Hobart as well, by the way. Like, this is amazing.
Did he get the first one, the very first tag match?
Well, it was a dark match. I'm not going to pull him up for nothing.
Okay.
Can he get the dark for bonus points in the game of life?
I see William Regal and Lance Storm.
Go on, son.
No way. Oh,
fuck, who did they wrestle?
No way.
Caught on, Botchico. The biggest one in your career if you get the Survivor Series 2002 dunk match. What was on the kickoff show?
I know Tommy Dreamer ran out to help at the end.
God.
The detail. This is what you come to this podcast for. Details about shows from 22 years ago.
Botchico should be writing this Wikipedia.
Who did they wrestle? That's going to annoy me. Because I was about to say Kane and Rob Van Dam, but they were in the Chamber match.
They were.
But that was a match at WrestleMania 19 on Sunday Night Heat.
I saw something. There it is.
So they wrestled. I'm trying to think.
Come on. I want you to get this so much.
It's annoying me. Now, Christian was heel at that point. So it wouldn't have been Christian.
Do you want a clue?
Yes.
They're not like a well known tag team. It looks very thrown together.
I'm going to say one of them's the Hurricane.
Yes.
Oh, jeez.
Yes.
Hurricane. The Hurricane be with. Oh.
Again, I've not known the Hurricane to be in a
TV
show. No.
Who was it?
Goldust.
Oh.
Like if there was ever on the dark match, right?
Yeah.
If there was ever a thrown together tag team for one night,
Goldust
and Hurricane.
I still, I'm impressed.
Yeah, I got 3 or 4.
So back to the main card. We've got 3 matches to go. So we finished off on
Victoria
versus Trish
Stratus on a hardcore match.
Right, so I'm thinking the match after that, if I'm not mistaken, was Big Show and Brock Lesnar for the WWE title.
Yep.
Brock Lesnar finally losing.
Yeah, and Heyman screwed him.
Yeah, Heyman screwed him.
4 minutes, 19 seconds.
Yeah, they only did 5 minutes. After that was the triple threat tag team match between Los Guerreros, Rey and Edge, and Benoit and Angle, underrated team.
Yeah, they were very good.
Underrated team.
Yep. There was a segment right after that where we saw Christopher Nowinski come out with Matt Hardy.
Oh, big pop, baby.
Scott started doing.
Yeah.
Then there was another promo after the Chamber came down, where Eric Bischoff came out and introduced the Elimination Chamber.
Can we all do like the WWE like steel structure is coming down noise?
Oh, the
yes.
I have it on my Spotify.
It's like white noise.
Yeah,
it's what I listen to.
Like that is my dream one day in FCW. If there is a cage match, I know we have like some places you can't put it on the sale to have that. That moment of the lights flashing, the dun 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 dun.
But it would be us like WrestleMania 2 style, like building the cage.
Yeah.
That music playing.
Well,
for, like, half
are we
going to
do FCW from 3 different points in Scotland?
Oh, we could do
that. And then we can have a battle royal, but we have the we have the, what's his name, the first team roster of Dundee United getting involved.
Yes.
I feel like Tony Watt could win that.
Right, so here's the Book It Commissioner of the Month. We have a show in Tulloch, Queen's Hotel and the Lark Centre at Tayport
on
the same day.
I think we should do that.
So Book It Commissioner. Yes. I'll try not say that for the rest of the episode because he hates it.
But he loves me.
I know.
You say it then.
No,
you can't say no to you.
He just hired me back and I feel like I'm pushing it.
Aye, right, okay, fair enough. So get out of here. So we're on to the chamber match.
If I remember correctly.
Well, you've got two of them already. You've got Kane and Van Damme.
I'm going to see if I can remember the order of entry.
Flexing over here.
See if I remember the order of entry. So if I remember correctly, going from last person coming into the match to the first people starting it. So the last person to come in was Shawn Michaels.
This is like, have you ever seen Survival Series on YouTube? It's like Wrestle Talk Show, where they do stuff in reverse chronological order. This is part of the day of the chamber match. Yeah. So Sean's in last, right? Okay. I don't know if you're right.
No, wait.
Okay, you got,
he's right.
Okay.
Then Kane.
Yep.
Then Booker T.
Oh my god.
Then Chris Jericho, and the match was started by Van Damme and Triple H.
Oh my god, he's got it!
Wow. Unbelievable scene.
I know. Like, because it's ironic that Van Damme started it because he was the first one eliminated. Because he did the 5-star off the cage.
He did, yeah. He did, I remember that. It was a good chamber match.
It was excellent. It's still the chamber match I'm holding. And plus, for me, big Shawn Michaels fan,
yeah.
Shawn Michaels wins the title.
His last only world title win when he came back.
Yeah.
Which is crazy when you think about it.
Oh, it was crazy. Like, I was such a big Shawn Michaels fan. I used to play him in all the games. Yeah. Then, like, every time we got a title match, I was so excited for Shawn Michaels to win the title again, and he never won it again. Yeah.
The one time where I really thought he would win it was, I think, in a ladder match with Jericho.
Yes,
like,
and they're holding the belt towards each other.
Round about that time, I thought, this is the time where Shawn's going to get one more run. You know,
I was going to say, there was only one time that I didn't want Shawn Michaels to win the World Heavyweight title, and that was at WrestleMania 20. And that's where we'll end that part.
Big Triple H fan.
Yeah. Like you said, what's his name? It was that weird word.
Stevie Richards was the third man in that match.
Yeah, he was.
Stevie Richards won the belt.
Remember that happened when Triple H, like, he lost the belt that night and then he couldn't find it again until, I think it was Unforgiven 2004, he found it. Randy Orton found it for him.
I only found out a couple of weeks ago as well that Stevie Richards was actually the one that ended the Undertaker streak as well.
That was crazy.
I know. I can't believe, like, we missed that. But anyway.
Yeah, sorry.
But Ken, I'll let you ask the second question here.
Okay, if you can tag team with any character, living, dead, real, no real.
Could be a wrestler, could be Agatha a comic book character. I like this. Agatha Christie.
Why Agatha Christie? She's badass.
She is badass.
Have you read her books? They're badass books. I was going to say, that takes some steel to get good. And I feel like she would be an amazing tag team partner. Wouldn't you be terrified if Agatha Christie just started firing up and just, like, laying into you? Like, you guys are a tag team now. Like, how terrified would you be standing across the ring for Botchico and Agatha Christie?
I would be a bit, like...
Well, why is this like, corpse still...
I think for the purposes of this, she's being reanimated.
Yeah, okay.
But I would be like, why is Botchico picked out of Christie? There's a reason.
There is a reason, guys. But think it this way: you question about her being reanimated, but you never question the Undertaker.
That's true.
No,
I'm not going to question the Undertaker.
Let's be honest.
He'll just bully me for, like, getting on with my fellow wrestlers. Exactly. Like, why are you
also? I'm like the Undertaker. Agatha Christie's undefeated at WrestleMania.
That's true. Facts. So are we. We're all undefeated at WrestleMania so far.
So far.
What would your team name be?
10 Little Botchicos.
10 Little Botchicos, there we go.
That would be our tag team. If Agatha Christie is not available, I would have to pick one of my favourites, Cactus Jack. Because I was a huge Mankind fan growing up. Like, Cactus Jack, Dude Love, Mick Foley, oh my god. Like, I don't know if you guys know this, Botchico's about a fat kid. And I didn't look like The Rock. I didn't look like Stone Cold Steve Austin. Mm. But I saw Mick Foley, and he wasn't fat, he was in shape. But he was unique, and I just gravitated towards that, and I loved this guy.
Like, you're doing it for the big lads.
He does it for the big lads.
Yeah.
Like, I remember one of the most painful memories as a child, which my dad never liked wrestling, so he never understood this. My grandfather loved wrestling, and he understood this. My grandfather also got to see me wrestle against Yuji Maki and Asylum, actually, in Tayport.
Nice.
Still caveat to that story. It was the way out 2000 where Mick Foley lost to Triple H. And
was that his retirement match? He retired for like 4 weeks.
And as a little kid,
is that the one at the Rumble? Did you see?
No way out.
Because they wrestled at the Rumble, No Way Out, and then Mick was back for Mania.
Because it was only at Rumble where they almost the pedigree.
Yeah.
We were just talking about that. Yeah. I think, on the
I didn't understand.
Or on the cell the month after. Sorry, Botchico.
Yeah,
sorry.
That's okay. Like I didn't realize. Hell in a Cell matches were cage matches at that point, so when he flew through the cage, I thought he'd won.
It's like a reverse cage match.
And I sat,
kicking him out.
And I sat there, like, actually, almost like in disbelief, thinking he's the champion.
Yeah.
He's going to Mania. He's going to fight The Rock. Oh my God, we're going to see like WrestleMania. You have the immovable object versus the irresistible force. You had the mega powers explode. To me, this was the Rock and Sock connection explode.
Yeah.
And then the match continued. And Mick went through the cage again, and he lost.
And
his
tooth came out.
No.
That was 98. Oh, was that the name?
Oh,
right, this is
post-tooth.
This is the plan.
He's followed up the cell a lot.
Yes, this is the plan. But yeah. That first one was not planned.
So, he lost, and I was 7 at that point. I cried that night because Mick Foley and Cactus Jack was no more. Until he made 5 different returns, that was. But you tell William Botchico that.
You don't know that it's a wrestling retirement.
I didn't know this.
Did you cheat to your bedroom with an Agatha Christie novel?
Yeah.
I did. I kind of lost. I lost myself in Death on the Nile.
Speaking of names, why didn't you call yourself Wrestlers on the Lucha Express?
Oh, there we go.
Kyle, can I have you actually on staff to write these names for me, please?
I'm available. I'll send you my rates.
Like 10%, yeah. Right. If you could have a match, Botchico, anyone, any wrestler, living or dead.
My neighbor's a cat, because he's a dick.
Oh, really? Lucha Cat now?
No, he's called Mr. Whiskers, and he's a dick.
Okay.
He always tears open my trash bags. I get it all over the street. Then the council phone me, and they're like, Mr. Botchico, we can't actually take your trash away. My house has, like, 5 feet of trash in front of it because that damn cat. I want that cat in a goddamn Inferno match.
Oh, wow. I was waiting to say what kind of match it would be.
It's going to be an Inferno match. And I'm going to make sure. And I love animals, but that cat is a dick. But now that I've just looked at my phone and Peter are threatening to sue me, we're going to change the answer I would love a match with Owen Hart.
Man after
my own heart.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Ha! Pun
no intended. You're funnier
than
you look.
I'd love a match for Owen Hart. Owen Hart is just one of like everyone talks about Brett. Don't get me wrong, Brett's fantastic. But oh my God, Owen.
Ken's on your side with us. Big Owen Hart boy.
Brett was such a great worker. It was, but Owen was almost equal to him. But Owen, oh my God, the speaking, the charisma, the stuff. Like he got Nugget over, for God's sake. The man also amazing. Like, him and Brett had an amazing match, SummerSlam 94. Matches like, you guys ever seen In Your House 16 Canadian Stampede? Oh, what a match! Like Owen Hart was like him and the Bulldog. Oh my God, him and the Bulldog, what a tag team. And then just hearing the stories about him in the back. But Owen Hart was just man taken way before his time.
Yeah.
And secondly, could you imagine, as we all hoped, it never happened. 1 year later, he's still in the Fed. Eddie Guerrero, Jericho, Dean Malenko,
Kurt Angle. Kurt Angle versus Owen Hart.
Other one named Redacted would also have been fantastic.
Yeah,
like
Perry Saturn, yeah.
Yeah, Perry Saturn. Even Rob Van Dam was only a year or two away. And can you imagine those matches he would have had with those guys? Oh my God, we could have seen this would have shot him into the stratosphere. Because I was standing by, little side note, I know I keep doing these side notes.
That's fine, this is what the podcast is about.
So
I love chatting, absolutely.
Tributaries. Yeah.
I like tributaries.
Before your I was very friendly with your old co-host. We used to sit and talk a lot.
Yeah.
And one of the things we did talk about was booking. We used to love talking about booking. Oh, what would be different? And my personal idea was to do a storyline from WrestleMania 10 to WrestleMania 11. Mm-hmm. Because we all agree, WrestleMania 11 is not a great WrestleMania.
No, there was a run of not great manias around that time.
And what my idea was to have... So I'm going to commit sacrilege because I was a Shawn Michaels fan.
Solid.
I wouldn't have had Shawn Michaels win the 95 Rumble. Mm-hmm. I would have had Bret Hart win the 95 Rumble. Because what I would have done is have Owen Hart win the title at SummerSlam 94 from Bret and build the story.
Was that one near the cage match?
Yes,
the
it cage is. Match, but, like, because he can get away with it. Like, he escapes out of the cage.
Yeah, exactly.
And Owen wins the title, goes on that year, and you have a story from WrestleMania 10 right to WrestleMania 11 of the brothers fighting. Yeah. And they would have an incredible match because the greatest lasting image I always think from WrestleMania 10 is, of course, you've got Bret up on the shoulders, the belt, is Owen walking into, coming down the ramp, standing there.
Because even when he beat Bret, Bret still ends the night as world champion.
Exactly. And, like, Owen is almost saying to him, how dare you take this moment from me? Of course you need to be it.
Because it's no longer the night that Owen beat Bret. It's, like I just said, it's when Bret won the title.
It was also the more like, oh, I'm coming for that.
Yeah.
You gotta watch your back.
Exactly. This is the story.
It's a shame that he was never champion.
Yeah. He should have been champion.
Did he ever have a match with Shawn?
He did have one match.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I've not seen it. I just
that actually
it was in your house raid in the cage
1996.
So
right,
so it's 3 Montreal. See, it's crazy that they never did a match
post
Montreal.
They were supposed to.
Yeah,
they were supposed to. But Shawn Michaels nixed it. So as much as I love Shawn Michaels,
because Owen would have battled.
Aye, yeah.
He's tied him up.
Did you watch a lot of his New Japan stuff?
I saw some of the stuff when he was really young.
Stuff he done with Pegasus Kid.
Pegasus Kid. Oh, like, this is, like, I sit and go back and watch just, like, old Owen Hart matches. Mm-hmm. And, like, why they never strapped the rocket onto this guy? I remember the they've strapped the rocket onto this guy because, like, you know, a lot of them just kind of went, oh, he was Brett's younger brother. It was like, he was just as good as Brett, but he could talk.
He was better than Brett. Mm-hmm. I stand by that statement.
I agree with you. Like, but that's the thing. Owen could talk.
Yeah, yeah. And Brett could. Brett was a charisma vacuum.
Yeah, like, oh my god, like, I can. This is why I want a match.
Again, I love Bret Hart, but he's boring to listen to. Yeah. We get in the ring, belt to belt, amazing. But,
like, Owen could read the phone book and make it interesting.
Yeah.
Secondly, the man could wrestle a stump and make it look 5 stars.
Yeah.
So, like, that's why I pick Owen Hart.
Yeah.
Like, the only person, like I said, I have respect for him, unlike Mr. Tinkles.
Another match I had with Shawn Michaels was a tag match, and it was Owen Hart and the British Bulldog versus Shawn Michaels.
Yeah, I know this one.
And Steve Austin.
Yes, led to the title reign of Shawn Michaels and Steve Austin, who were feuding at the time.
Yeah. It was a Raw match in 97.
Exactly.
There you go. Attitude Era, where the tag champs are the main eventers who are fighting each other for the world title.
Yes, that happened all the time. Kane and Mankind, Undertaker and Big Show, Austin.
Yeah. Austin and Foley had it at one point as well.
Austin and Foley, Triple H,
Triple H and Austin, two-man power trip.
Oh, two-man
power trip. It was a world title, and a Cornell title, and the tag titles at one point.
I stand by the greatest...
Was that all at the same time? Can't remember.
Yeah. I stand by the greatest tag team was the tag team I created when I used to play Here Comes the Pain. And that was
the best wrestling game, Commissioner.
Yes.
The best wrestling game.
I will fight you. I will fight you too. But I'll wait until he's after fought you and he's tired.
Yeah. Exactly, yeah, good strategy.
The greatest tag team I used to put in that was Big Show. It was Goldberg and Brock Lesnar as a tag team because they were the two strongest guys and they would just dominate. But I used to also give them an entrance where they had a car and they drove them to the ring.
Nice. Do you know who I hated wrestling on that game? I always found it hard to beat him was Kevin Nash. Kevin Nash was...
Did you target his quad?
No, I didn't. See, that's where I was going wrong. I always went for his arms. She went for legs.
This is why I had a great mistake. I had the greatest tactic in Here Comes the Pain. And you know what that was? I'll teach you the secret.
Okay.
I'll teach you the secret too, Karen.
Yeah.
The secret was, what he did was, he jumped out of the ring at the ramp side, got the table, put it in the corner, and then, as soon as somebody came towards you, you ran into the table, and they'd grapple you, put you through the table, and get disqualified.
Boom. It was a good speedrun career mode, though.
That's an up there for thinking one, by the way, boys.
In my career mode, I once did two career modes as Ultimo Dragon and the Hurricane, which were WrestleMania main eventers in my career.
Yeah, absolutely.
And they had a winning streak of 120 victories.
Nice.
110 of them were DQs.
So the only ones you had to win were actually title matches where you had to like
pin them. Yeah, because there were no disqualifications, so I used to hit them with the chair and the sledgehammer all the time.
That's benefit.
I was going to say, as Kairn says, down here for thinking, up here for dancing.
That's right. You're normal time. Of course. You keep that one. So, was there any other profession other than wrestling, what would you be doing?
Well, I became a wrestler because I couldn't sing or dance.
Mm.
But I suppose there is one, and it might surprise you. You've seen some of my glossy promos and beautiful camera angles.
Yep.
And that would be film director.
Mm.
I am like a little known fact about Botchico. I love film. Mm. Film is one of my jams.
Botchico film.
Dun, dun. Wasn't a Duran Duran fan.
What's your favourite film?
My favourite film, believe it or not, it's like this one's
a big question, but like give
it's
us
a
one.
Huge
it's
question.
It's hard to one down to one.
Give us one all of you. One all of you.
I
one all of you.
One, but I just to kind of give you an idea how strange it is. It's like I love lots of films. I love something like, say, Blade Runner. Love Blade Runner.
Mm-hmm.
Right, same excellent film. I wrote essays on it.
Mm.
But at the same time, I love something rubbish like The Expendables. I love The Expendables. The Expendables is great. Like, I've seen stuff like Cobra, Sylvester Stallone. Terrible film. Love it. And then.
It's good.
Yeah.
Recently, I've seen The Iron Claw, and oh my god.
How was it? I was wanting to go and see it.
It's such a good movie.
I was wanting to go and see it. With
so,
you, but it
so good.
I'll
come with you guys again to see it. That's how much I enjoyed this film.
We'll talk about this after. Maybe Sunday. Anyway, sorry.
So, like, I love all these films, but my favourite film of all time, are you ready for this?
Yes.
1976. Gene Wilder's Willy Wonka and the Chocolate Factory.
Good show.
One of the greatest films I ever saw. Mm-hmm. Mostly because of what an amazing world. Loved the book, loved the world that they built, but also loved Gene Wilder, man.
Yeah.
What fun fact about Kairn for that film?
Yes.
That is one of my favourite songs. I won't tell you which one, I'll let you speculate, but one of my favourite songs ever is in that film.
Right.
You can keep that one, you can figure that out.
I don't know, you do look like an Oompa Loompa fan.
I'll let people speculate.
Just because he's orange, so.
I've not went for my tan yet.
No, I'm not about your skin.
That's because
I call you Ginger Tan for a reason.
Wait, your tan, is that why you're lying in the bath with the tea bags?
Yes.
Okay.
But you don't put any sugar or milk in.
Was a wee miss there.
What'd you miss?
No, you missed.
Doesn't matter. Right, last question, Botchico.
Okay.
Why do you wrestle?
That's an interesting question. You know what? The reason I wrestle was... It's kind of hard to put into words. Like, kind of grab the thoughts into, like, you know... into a kind of continuous narrative is, I suppose it comes down to the fact that obviously growing up wasn't like the greatest at sports. I tried them, wasn't amazing. And then, like, because I used to, like, kind of interesting point, I mean, you both talked about this, I like football.
Mm-hmm.
I was never as good as the footballers. Like, I hear trying to be Henrik Larsson, but I was never as good.
Nobody can be Henrik Larsson.
No, no one can.
We know this.
But watching wrestling, it just kind of took you to another world. Like, mm-hmm. It made me forget these, like, really...
Escapism, isn't it?
It's escapism, mm-hmm. But you believe in these guys. As I said, we talked about Mick Foley last...
Yeah, just about to see you. You're talking about Mick Foley.
Yeah, Mick Foley was just such a hero of mine. Like, I was with him every single time. And I remember the first time I went to an independent wrestling show. It was actually in Helensburgh. In Helensburgh Town Hall. And, oh my god, sitting there, like, you'd think that I rediscovered the wheel the first time, just sitting watching this match. And it was just the excitement, like, the music, the atmosphere, even just seeing the ring.
Yeah.
Seeing the ring for the first time, my god. Like, I was like, oh my god, that's a wrestling ring. I was so excited with that. And they had a Royal Rumble that night.
And I'd never seen a, I'd seen a Royal Rumble on TV. I was like, oh my god, look at these.
Oh my god, this is happening.
Yeah, like the best way to put this, this was like comic book characters coming to life. I was watching real life comic characters. Like, forget Marvel. Forget, like, DC.
Good, because I famously don't know about that.
That's fair enough. But like, seeing that in front of me for the first time is just wow. And these guys were like, above humanity.
Yeah.
Like, these are guys who are like gods, and they're like wrestling. And I was just so excited. You know what? I was actually so excited that a young Botchico actually got in trouble at that show because I climbed into the ring and tried to run the ropes.
Did you?
I was just a calling.
I ran the ropes.
Did you do it properly or did you do it Snoop Dogg style?
I don't know. I can't remember. All I remember is being grabbed by my ankles by a very angry steward and getting marched back to my seat to watch the rest of the show and being told that I should be thankful that I'm not being.
I was going to say, at least you didn't get sucked out.
Yeah.
You'd think this would have been a rare occurrence. I did this at.
Good that you made your debut for that promotion.
Oh, yeah.
Well done.
Put it on your CV.
Interesting story to that. I did that. The next three wrestling shows I went to, including that one, I did that exactly all three wrestling shows. I got kicked out of the ring by climbing in and running the ropes. I was that excited.
Good that you didn't learn your lesson.
I was that excited.
Yeah.
And look where it's led to me.
Yeah.
I might not be the best, but you know what? I've got the heart.
You do.
What it is like, that's why I do wrestling. It's because it just transcends. Like, you know, people come to our shows. Work sucks.
I know.
Life sucks. Okay, Blink.
Yeah, I
know. All this stuff sucks. Life sucks. But see, for like 90 minutes to 2 hours.
That's why WrestleMania is 2 nights then. Or is it a normal AEW?
You're definitely a Wrestle Kingdom boy.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's like for that 2 hours, we can all forget. It's like I said, when I mentioned movies, skip to a movie. Like watching these guys, you have a good time. You have a drink. You cheer. You boo. You interact because. I remember doing that myself, and it was such an experience. It made me forget about the bad things
in life.
Like, all I cared that night was the hero won. That's all that ever mattered to me. Like, in WWF, all that mattered to me was Mick Foley won. And I hated Triple H for years because of that. And the fact is that the man is now considered one of the greatest, like, you know, promoters in the country. But I remember hating that man. He's got to me now when I watch the shows. Back then, I hate it, and that's the effect that's. And every time I go out there, I remember being that kid in the front row and just going, like, you know, just hoping, like, I'll walk to the back if I see kids up there and start high fiving them and taking pictures of them because I remember standing there going, I hope they come up and see me.
Yeah,
I want them to come up and see me, and that's why we do it. It's not like I don't need to prove. I don't want to go in there and prove anything, like, other than, like, you know, like to these kids out there, it's like, you can do this. Like, don't let anything get in your way. I had bad times, they had bad times.
You have been doing that ever since you came back. Like, if you hadn't got injured in that match, I would have went anywhere. I think whoever was stepping in front of you at that point was going to get knocked down. Because you've turned up. Me and Kieran have seen this the last year. You're not the same guy you were when I first joined the company. Not that you weren't a good wrestler or a good person, but you've cranked everything up to 11 in the last year, and it's paying off, man.
Yeah.
It's good to see.
And
it's like a new...
You found a new level.
Yeah.
That you're working at.
You're punching through that ceiling, I think, that maybe you'd even placed on yourself.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not too bold as to say that.
I'm
putting my neck out on the line.
Yeah.
You're going to be a champion in SCW one day because of the work you're putting in. And if you keep doing that, then the sky's the limit for you, mate.
Yeah. See, I very much appreciate that. You know what? I'm okay not being a champion. For one reason only. And that's not because that's my goal. Second, what it actually is as long as those kids, those fans, walked away going, we were damn entertained by that, man.
And they will be.
That's what I want.
You're most entertaining thing in the company.
Like I said, I want those kids to walk away and think about that. And you know what? I'll give them a little special shout out here. Charlie.
Yes.
Charlie comes to those shows. And I didn't have the greatest year before I came back. That kid kept his belief going. He turned up every sign, and you know what? Even when things weren't great for me, I looked at those signs, and I remember, like, you know what? Even when you don't think you're doing well, somebody thinks you're doing well, and that always matters to me. And you know what? That is the reason I became a wrestler. And If I can inspire someone like they inspired me,
I like that. It's like giving that kid that same feeling that you got when you were a kid.
Yeah.
It's like very full circle.
Yeah, we got a cycle, man.
Yeah.
Finish your story.
Finish your story. I was gonna say I don't need two WrestleManias for that.
No. That's just one name I've seen, maybe.
Yeah. The only thing that I will
just
stand
in your face.
The only thing I will stand by is I'm gonna try and finish that story, as you've pointed out. And they said, I want those kids to come and see those shows. Mm-hmm. And secondly, if they want me to be a champion, I said it doesn't matter. They want me a champion. Hell yeah, I'm gonna try and be a champion.
Whenever we do eventually get FCW Here Comes the Pain, that is when Botchico gets a shot at a championship, and that's when he wins. Because it's a superior wrestling game.
Yes.
Yep. So Botchico, if you don't know already, you've been watching the FCW podcast for the first time, we will go through the card in no particular order, but I think we know what the main event is going to be, so let's leave the main event until last. We'll give it the position on the card that it deserves.
I have some conflicting feelings about that main event.
Yeah.
We'll get into that when
we get
there.
But let's go through this card. So you got it in front of you there?
I do have it in front of me.
I'll give you the honour, Mr. Douglas, of picking the first match that we talk about tonight.
Shall we do Randy Valentine versus Big New Boy Golden?
Yes.
Can I just make a big shout out to my gala buddy friend Randy?
Got it. Gala buddy's
for August.
Right, before we go on about this match, can you exclusively reveal on the SW podcast if there's a potential of the Gala Buddies getting back together this summer, now that you've been reinstated in the company?
Look, I can't actually say for definite. All I'm saying is there's two people who know about this, who might know what's going to happen, and they're not even going to be on the same plane as each other.
Oh,
that's how secret this is.
Wow.
So I don't know what's going to happen. I don't know what's happening. Randy doesn't know what's happening. We'll just see. Like, what are we on? What's the date today?
16th of February as we record this.
Yes. All I'm saying is gala season is less than 3 months away.
So you're telling me there's a chance?
A possibility.
Like, as Lloyd Christmas would say, you're telling me there's a chance.
Exactly. Yes.
Yes.
That's all I need.
We'll see. All I'm going to say is, we'll see.
I'm excited. But anyway, we'll park that until gala season. Randy Valentine versus Wolf. So this match has come about basically because of what happened at the Queen's Hotel.
Yes.
At the Dundee Academy of Pro Wrestling.
What happened to Randy at the Queen's Hotel?
So, Randy got battered
by Solomon Grum.
Solomon Grum had his wicked way with him. Holden got involved as well.
Wait. Randy Valentine got
Yes.
The Randy Valentine.
Yes.
Retro Randy Valentine.
Right, come on, you're having me on. Not Reverend Randy Valentine or retired Randy Valentine. Retro Randy Valentine.
Like, are you sure you're not making
a gala buddy?
Yeah.
You sure you're not mixing up with Radical Randy Valentine?
I'm not, no.
Or
because there would have been no contest if Radical
Randy Valentine. Or his known cousin Riverboat Randy Valentine, the captain.
No.
Right. I don't know about you guys.
I mean, I said there would be no contest. There was a no contest because the match had to get thrown out because of Holden's interference.
Yeah, I had to run out and help Randy get back because it was just they brutalized him.
Wait, is Randy okay?
I think so. I mean, he's accepted this match against Holden, so he must be.
Okay, like,
the commissioner's approved it, so
I'm actually quite shocked because, you know, me and Randy, you know what we think. You know, we've been together.
Yeah.
Like, so go on, tell me more.
Well, so, I mean, Holden and Grum have got this new alliance now, and they seem just hell bent on destroying everyone that's in the path right now.
Whoever can pay them the best, I think.
Good thing to point that out. Was this maybe a hit that's been put on Randy by somebody that we don't know about? Who knows?
What's his name?
I mean, that's just pure speculation, but you know.
Like, who would have done this? Is it Dickie Divers? Is it like ADM?
Who knows?
Is it Rich Money?
Who knows?
It's gotta be one of them.
I know, right? But again, potential suspects there, but the main thing is now Randy's barely survived Solomon Grum. Now he's got Holden on Empire. What do you think's going to happen in that one? Because I can't see anything apart from a similar outcome. Because Grum will be there backing up his body, his tag team partner. The Prophets of Doom, as they've been coined.
Prophets of Doom.
And if ever a name was fitting of a tag team, Solomon Grum and Holden, the Prophets of Doom. It doesn't get more on the nose than that.
I've I've been in the room with both of these guys.
Yeah, so have I. I've been hit by them a lot, and it sucks.
Yeah.
Let's put it this way. The last time I was in the ring with Holden, I remember him clotheslining me so hard that I saw it three rows back. Mm-hmm. Like, you guys ever seen Doctor Strange?
Mm-hmm.
You know how the astral projection? That was me. I saw myself getting clotheslined three rows back. That's how hard this man hits.
You ever seen the Scooby-Doo movie?
Yes.
Yeah.
You know when they take the
yeah.
the wee heads?
Yeah.
That's what he's talking about, because yeah. I know you're not into...
No, I know Scooby-Doo.
I know. I thought you'd know that.
It's an accurate representation.
Especially when Holden
hits you.
Yeah.
It's like, you know you...
But
it's an accurate
representation. It's not as big as we're all making out.
Oh, don't start this.
Have you heard this?
So the Kairn's got a bit of an issue with understanding how big these guys are. Which is quite strange, because you literally saved me from Solomon Grumman.
I know, but he's not that big. Look, it's all forced perspective. You've seen Lord of the Rings.
Yeah.
Right.
I skipped through it.
They're not hobbits on the actually that small. Gandalf's not actually that big. They're just normal.
Like,
it's the same with Grum and Softy.
I saw like there was like something about a ring, and then the next thing I knew there was like eagles. But I may have.
That's not the point.
Don't get him started.
The point is, they're not that big. That ring adds an extra foot, 2 foot on. The big boys, but they're not as big as people make out.
Kairn, the last time I got clotheslined by Grum or Holden, I had to get skin grafts put on my chest.
That says more about you than them, though, doesn't it?
I don't know how you see this. Like, Pat, you're his friend.
I've been trying.
He's watched the behind the scenes of Peter Jackson too many times. It's forced perspective, I'm telling you.
Just wait until we're in the ring with them one day, because it's going to happen, right? Because we're going to have to go through them at some point.
Solomon Grum shook my hand, and it was like I put my hand in
their face. I'll let you live in this fantasy land, mate, because you're going to get a very rude awakening when they walk through that cup.
I'm not the one living in behind cameras and believing it's all real. I know the truth. It's all visual effects. It's all hocus-pocus. Anyway, back onto this.
Right, Botchico, you're the guest. I'll let you pick the next match. Right, you've got the card.
Let's have a look here. You know what? I am going to pick... There we go. I'm going to go with ADM versus Hunter Samson with... our very special guest referee, Skull!
Yeah.
Caleb Valhalla.
The vengeful referee.
Yes.
No. I was going to say, like, if I'm ADM, I would be terrified, like, knowing that, you know, a man like Caleb Valhalla is going to be even near me. I mean,
you say that. ADM's been actively calling out Caleb for the longest time now. And like, ADM is one of the few men in Scottish wrestling that I don't think is scared of Caleb Valhalla.
No.
What does that say about ADM? He just wants to like get in the ring with him and avenge his loss to him.
Yeah. Well, it makes me think that maybe he's taking a couple of head injuries, because I would be terrified. Like, I've never wrestled Caleb Valhalla. I've only ever been in a rumble with him. We were Final Four, and I saw him across the ring, and I even was like, God, if you want to win this, I've got to take out Caleb Valhalla.
Yeah. Daunting, isn't it?
It's a daunting time. I mean, the man is the only two-time FCW champion.
Yep, correct.
You don't. It's nothing to sneeze at, man.
Absolutely not. Hard enough to win that title once, never mind twice.
Mm. That's true. Isn't Tommy Cross the only one to have beaten him?
Tommy Cross was the first man to beat him.
He was the first man.
Caleb's had a couple of losses since then, but it was seismic when Tommy was able to do that, because Caleb was like 3 years and he hadn't lost.
Like, I remember seeing Caleb like his first night in the FCW and being like, oh baby, this is
business just picked up, as they say.
Like, I generally was like going to people like, you know, what's his name, Norse mythology, is that one of the guys from bloody Valhalla?
I mean, they fucking named the place after him.
I know. And what scares me is the fact is the man comes in just full of energy and it never drops in that single moment.
So Hunter Samson is taking on ADM in this one. We've seen a bit of Hunter before.
Yes,
one of the Power Pro guys from down in Fife.
Showed up in the Rumble, didn't he?
Yeah.
I remember seeing him.
He took it to Caleb that night as well.
He did.
So it's going to be very interesting to see how he does against
a lot of bad blood there.
Well, that's an interesting dynamic, because Caleb isn't the biggest fan of either of these guys. So how's Caleb going to call it?
I think he might have to call it as my enemy and my enemy is my friend.
He might have to call it straight down the middle.
Straight down the middle.
Yeah. Okay. More power pro.
I don't know what that
is.
I have no idea where that came from.
No. Just but, it feels good though, doesn't it?
Yeah, weirdly so. That or it's just...
I'm not a big fan of the power, but it's a good song.
As you say, it felt good, but that might be due to the fact that my face is partially paralysed from the hot sauce.
Yeah. You took that like a champ, by the way. You took it all better than you.
It's because you put hands on and you put a big foot on it. I have the video evidence.
You know what I'm hearing? You know what I'm hearing, Botchico? Excuses.
Excuses. You wouldn't let me dab yours on. You were like, no, I've got it. Yeah. But you dabbed mine on and gave me a
That's my
hot sauce.
To be fair, I thought to my over and took the sauce onto the tongue.
Yeah.
But
you regretted it about 5 minutes later when you went bright red. Yes, I could see it through the mask.
I was going to say, some people probably thought, it's because of how red I went through the mask, I went, is that Spike Tierney?
Yeah.
No, I thought that before I tried the hot sauce.
Did he hear us?
I know, right? Oh, we were speaking to
it was the hot sauce that cleared
I've got a heightened sense of hearing since that hot sauce.
But, yeah, like, just the final note on ADN versus, what's
the meat division match of the evening.
Oh.
And boy, do I love those big meaty men slapping that meat.
Speaking of meaty men, should we talk about the Meat Factory versus Foundation?
Right. Well, let's move on to that then.
Yeah, let's...
I'll ignore the fact that you've skipped my turn.
It's fine,
because then you can shut up about the hot sauce because you've licked my tongue. Tag team championship match.
I just want to point out, FCW at the moment might be the hottest tag team division.
It is, but not even for this match, but we'll get onto that later. Again, I feel like I said this on the podcast before, and it is a bit of a cliche. The word dream match gets thrown around in wrestling so much, and it's always, well, not always, usually unwarranted. It's hype, trying to get you in the door. But come on, you've got the foundation of the future, SCW Tag Team Champions, which in my book means you are the best tag team in the country at any given time, against, apart from a tag team we're going to talk about in a minute, my favourite tag team in Scottish wrestling, the Meat Factory, John Kerr and Craig Berry.
I
am so ready for this match!
I just want to say in this match, when me and Spike were together, I've been in the ring with Foundation in the Future. They bring it.
Oh, yes.
Oh, my God. I've never been that was, you guys talked earlier about, kind of push your boundaries. That was when you have boundaries. Zach Dynamite, Ryan Riley, oh, my God. You start finding stuff where you're like, how do I beat these guys?
Yeah.
But that being said, you're all as good as your last match. No, amazing victory over Casino Brutale. Maybe some questionable tactics to win it, but
that's the thing that lets them down, though. Because they don't need to do that, but they do it anyway. They get away with it because they're that clever. They can bend the rules.
They can,
without getting caught.
That's what I hate about them is the fact that they don't need to do that. They're so good that they can just do it on pure skill alone. However,
they'll do it anyway because they can. Because they're not
going to get away with it.
Exactly.
However, this is a different game against the Meat Factory. Craig Berry, what's his name? John Kerr. Oh my God. One little fact is, one of the people I started with was John Kerr.
Mm-hmm.
And I can't put over how great this guy is. And the fact that you just put him with Craig Berry. Craig Berry, who I finally got to meet after a couple of years, I was not disappointed when I met this man. They have formed such an amazing team. The fact is, they took on their trainer.
Yeah, Andy Roberts. Tommy Cartel, one of the, we've talked a lot about Power Pro right now, but they've been on a few of our shows in the past. The two of the best guys out of that school, say Andy's the trainer. Yeah. Tommy Cartel's one of the staff students.
He was the hardest man in Fife until I threw him out of the Rumble, right? That's how it works, right?
So there's a bit of a contention amount. So you could argue that he's technically still the hardest man in Fife.
Am I the hardest man in Fife?
He did technically lose his title when Daisy Jenkins beat him in the Fatal 5-Way. So she's now the hardest wrestler in Fife. So Tommy's technically the hardest man still. He's hanging on to that.
Yeah, but am I the hardest masked man in Fife now?
You're the hardest masked man wherever you go, Botchico. You're definitely the hardest masked man in Fife when we go to Taper.
Oh, yes.
Yes, but I'm looking forward to going back there later this year.
As we get some guests, that'll be good.
But, yeah, again, there's a great example. Meat Factory took on their trainer and beat him. Mm-hmm. And, you know what, in those singles matches, the Ardler comp.
Nay Mercy and Ardler, yeah, Ardlermania, yeah. They got revenge for that.
They got revenge, but the thing is, I think Andy Roberts was scared in those matches, quite frankly.
Yeah, what do you think? You think?
I think
he showed it that day, didn't he? He was terrified.
He was terrified.
I don't think he was just putting it on as much as he was trying to make out.
No, I think
when you saw him behind Tommy Cartel, he was trying to kiddie on like Tommy as if like, oh, like you need to help him. But Andy's like, he's a cerebral man.
He's a cerebral man, but like,
but he also knows how dangerous.
He's a thinking man.
John is. He was in their wheelhouse. He'd gotten the better of Craig and John in singles contests. That's where Andy Roberts thrives. He's one of the best in Europe.
Oh yeah. He's got the title.
Exactly. He's one of the best singles wrestlers in Europe, but he was in there in a tag team match with John Cale and Craig Berry. And they were looking good for a while, to give them credit, Cartel and Roberts. But the Meat Factory pulled through because they're a tag team.
See, I don't know if Cartel was quite on Andy's wavelength.
No.
Because
that's what let them down in the end.
I think that's what let them down. And you know what? Credit to Tommy Cartel. The man wanted to win it. Mm-hmm. One went fair square off of pure ability.
Yeah.
Andy
wasn't caring how he got there. And it cost him in the end.
It did cost him in the end. And let's be honest, like that kind of mentality of when it all costs, there's a reason Andy has won so many titles.
And the when found, take it back to the foundation.
Yeah, sorry.
No, that's okay. Tangents are fine. One of the things that I remember people thinking was, right, Foundation have got these championships. Nobody's winning them for a long time.
Oh, yeah.
If anyone can take them off them this early in the reign, it's the Meat Factory, who, pardon the obvious pun, are hungry, hungry boys. They've never held tag team gold, to my knowledge. Correct me if I'm wrong. I don't think they have.
I don't think they have.
Oh, no.
But it's a matter of when, not if, they hold tag team gold. And I would love for them and for FCW if they could mark their first championship victory in FCW, because what a story that would be to look back on in years' time, because these two are going to go on in a very, very good career. So two young lads.
Oh, completely agree.
Again, sky's the limit for them. I think very highly of them both. Fantastic wrestlers. How amazing will it be to say was their first championship win was in Perth City Wrestling. Mm-hmm. That's where it all started for them.
Yeah. One of the things I have to point out, though, is this against this actually kind of against Foundation, actually. This is new territory for them. I know Casino Brutal, that was new territory, but this is a completely different game. And no disrespect to Casino Brutal, because they put in a hell of an effort.
No, the first time I'd seen them, and I was not disappointed. Fantastic time. I hope they come back.
Robbie Romero, I'd actually met him a couple of months ago, and nothing but respect for the guy.
Yeah.
The Mikey Devine.
Horsepower Mikey Devine, loved him. Thought it was fantastic.
I thought he was amazing in the ring, and secondly, top class human being.
Yeah.
But This is gonna be a test for what's his name, Zach Dynamite and Ryan Riley. Like I don't know if they know what they're getting into. It's just the pure power that they are coming up against. And again, their experience might give them the advantage, but I wouldn't count out the Meat Factory picking up the W.
It's a different prospect for
different ballgame.
Ballgame. But in this classic again, avoiding the cliches I'm trying to, but one thing Commissioner Kevin Williams is very good is putting together fascinating matchups where you're like, I can't pick a winner.
Yeah.
Because there's nothing more boring than going to a wrestling show and thinking, oh, he's going to beat him easily, she's going to beat her easily. What you want is competitive matchups. Yeah. And that's one thing FCW, I think, are better at than any wrestling company out there right now.
Well, the only prediction I can make, like, again, purely off speculation, I think Meat Factory edge it narrowly.
Mm-hmm.
I'd love to
see it. Well, this is it. I was going to bring it up. Kate.
That's the only thing that's been pondered in my mind during this conversation is, and have they prepared for that?
They have 100% factored in the need of Bruiser Brad Evans, because I've said it before and I'll say it again. Ultimately, why are Foundation of the Future Tag Team Champions? Bruiser Brad Evans.
True.
Game that One is. Had their number the first two times they wrestled them. They looked like they were going to pick up the hat trick win against them. Before it all went wrong, Bruiser Brad Evans came in, won the championships for them. I'll go out there and say it.
Yeah.
Duke didn't take it very well. We know how that's gone.
Like
But yeah, I mean, Meat Factory, that's the sad thing. They're not just going to have to deal with two of the best wrestlers in the country, they're going to have to deal with three of them.
Yep.
Like, that's one thing I'm very thankful about, was when I wrestled Foundation of the Future, I didn't have to meet Brad Evans. I don't know how I could have handled that.
Like, he's an absolute mountain of a man.
Yeah.
I believe
the chiseled out of granite.
Oh yes. I believe the instruction manual for when taking him on is to grab your knees, lie down on the floor, lie sideways, and cry a lot. And hope he thinks that you're not a threat.
Yeah. Hedgehog it.
You're hedgehog. You play possum. Play possum.
Can I apologize.
Right.
I want to talk about ourselves, Kim.
Are you going for another?
It's been a long time coming. But you know what? We've worked our arses off.
Mm-hmm. I'm going to let you guys have this one while I step out for a
minute. Oh, yeah. Careful with the set.
Jeez, oh.
God's sake.
Set costs a lot.
Leave it. It's fine. Don't worry about it. There we go. Right. You can come back when we're... Because I'm going to end up getting into a rant here, Kim.
I'm going to let you guys do it.
I am, right. So, Kairn Douglas,
mm-hmm.
Patryk Patelski. You may have seen
our
promos on Facebook there about how we've ended up becoming a tag team.
Yes.
Been paused for a long time now.
Yep.
We've been helping each other out.
Mm-hmm.
And we thought, let's make this a permanent thing. Let's put a label on it, etc., etc. If you want the hilarity, go and watch the video.
Yes.
I mean, you like a laugh.
We do.
We don't take ourselves too seriously because life's too short.
Life is too short.
But comes a time where the sloshing does need to stop and the business starts with that bell.
Action needs to happen.
So, at the Tulloch Institute, March 1st,
yes.
Not safe for nobs, Kairn Douglas and Patryk Patelski are taking on Titanium No More. Christ, I nearly called him Titanium Tom Atlas because it just rolls off the tongue. I wish he was because he was a nice guy back then. But anyway. Sorry, the Fallen Son, Tom Atlas.
Is that his name?
It is, yeah. He's trying to make it happen, you know. A bit like Fetch, but, you know. Versus God's Gift to Professional Wrestling, Sebastian Asher.
Cheating, didn't he?
The Fallen Gods, as they're now going by. You hear this, Botchico?
Yeah. Sorry, I have to jump in here.
So Tom and Sebastian, obviously, Fallen...
Is that wee Tom Atlas?
Wee Tom Atlas. Fallen Son, Tom Atlas. He keeps trying to get this name over.
Fallen Son.
Yeah, and God's Gift to Pro Wrestling, as we know, Sebastian Asher. They've now dubbed themselves the Fallen Gods.
Right? Is this Fallen Son that he's trying to go over? Yeah. The same way that he was trying to explain the definition of insanity?
Well, we'll get to that.
Do you know the definition of insanity?
We're going to address that in a separate video, I think, because we've got a lot of ideas.
Can I just jump in? Because obviously I jumped out of the room, but I had to come back in just to talk about you two.
Yeah.
Like, I'm so happy to see you guys in this match because.
Thanks, man.
I was here before you guys turned up.
Yeah.
And I just want to point out, you guys have been two of the greatest additions to FCW.
Thank you.
And individually, but teaming up, oh my god, you've doubled it.
Yeah, man.
And I think, what are they called again? The Fallen Gods?
The Fallen Gods.
God, only something like Sebastian Asher would come up with that. He really is an asshole, isn't he?
He is an asshole.
Yes. But, I was going to say, I personally think, not only is Tulloch's mum's not safe that night, they are not safe.
Yeah. Well, we were just kind of talking about how we do love a laugh and a joke. We don't take ourselves too seriously because life's too short. But let's have a laugh. But there comes a time where you need to get a bit.
After what they've done at Tulloch in January, they've crossed the line.
We couldn't take that line down. Kairn got involved and helped. You and Jay jumped into even the odds. Rich Money was giving me loads of grief on commentary. I was having to try and deal with him.
Really is unlikable. Isn't
and then the next day, during the championship match,
mm-hmm.
Sebastian, after he'd technically not cheated per se by knocking me out with brass knuckles, getting around the rules in the triple threat match, but anyway, he'd cheap victoried his way to that final against Hunter Redwood.
Yes.
More shenanigans took place. You had Duke and you had Tom Atlas come out to try and interfere in the main event.
They're taking liberties.
Myself and Kairn weren't having that, so we came out and tried to stop it. And this, of course, as you were saying, the night after Kairn Williams got his head caved in by Duke. And
what's going on with Duke?
I don't know.
Now after what he's done, I don't really care. I don't care how he's got there. The fact that he's there and what he's done.
I've been trying to reach him for months because he's not been on the show. I'm washing my hands.
I get this. This is my first time talking about it on record, to be quite honest. And me and Duke, we're close, man. Yeah. We were close. And I remember people coming up to me and saying, "Can you believe? I can't believe Duke Cannon did that. I can't believe Duke Cannon did that." And I remember saying to them, "I don't want people to come up to me anymore and say I can't believe Duke Cannon did that, because quite frankly, I can't believe Duke Cannon did that. But I believe in my two goddamn eyes, and what I saw was Duke Cannon doing that."
Exactly.
But you know what? That's a different argument for a different day. Let's get back to this match.
We need, after all that went on last year with Marcus Hunter. Staging a hostile takeover, essentially. We thought we'd gotten through all that. And then I'm not saying that these three are trying to take over the company. Because remember, Duke had left SCW. He was not coming back. He turned on his partner at the time, Nathan North, after he lost the titles. And he'd said in his video that he was done with SCW. But Kairn Williams had advertised him for a show. And he dragged him in. And he felt like he was being dragged back to a company that he'd walked out on. And this seems to have been the retaliation.
I think he's his advantage to get the one-up on Kev that he was trying to get.
Look
what he done. Look what he done at Tulloch at the start of January.
One of Kairn Williams' best friends, Duke. And he caved his head in with a steel chair.
Can you point out, what's happened? Because he went from man who stood beside Kairn Williams
in the trenches with him.
He stood in the trenches and he fought on his team to make sure Kairn Williams won back FCW. And then
4 months later, what's going on? What is going on with you? But again, he went dark. I've been trying to get an answer from him for months and he won't do it. And now he's got his two lapdogs, Tom Atlas and Sebastian Asher.
Feels like Tom Atlas just latches on to anyone.
I feel that.
He just, because really, Ewan, and then that didn't work out.
Because I saw it firsthand. Mm-hmm. As you pointed out earlier in the podcast, me and Ewan had a moment, and Tom Atlas is standing there telling Ewan what to do, and I was just I remember standing there going, "What the hell do you have to do with this?"
Yeah, this is between me and Ewan. There's none to do with you.
Next thing you know, he tries to cheap shot me, and but. The fact is, he's now latching on to Duke Cannon. And
the word latching is very good.
Latching is a very good word.
Latching Tom Atlas.
I remember saying it at the time. Latching Tom Atlas. And this is, in hindsight, this is very interesting. Because I remember saying at the time, is this something that Tom signed up for? And he's not getting it with you. And Duke's been saying, I don't know if it's signed up. So, who knows how long this has been?
Who's been in the works?
Who in the works for? Is Duke being this little bird that's been in Tom Atlas's ear? And then of course you have Sebastian Asher then all of a sudden kicking Marcus Hunter to the cub after he'd Chris Omar Muhammad. That kind of came out of left field.
Yeah.
Well, we thought maybe Sam's turned the corner here, but no. Sebastian a month later is now on side with Tom and with Duke. So what's going on?
Well, why I'd be very careful with Sebastian Asher, because that man doesn't have friends. That man has associates that everyone can be bought and paid for with him. And he only does what he can to further his own agenda. Yeah. So, you saw it with Marcus Hunter. You saw it with Omar Muhammad. Hell, you saw it with, what's his name? The FCW Junior Heavyweight title. Yeah. Do you think he cared about, the tradition of that belt?
He didn't care that he hadn't won it properly.
He wanted the status that went with it. And
well, he's got it now with the Dub title. Inaugural Dundee Academy Professional Wrestling Champion. By hook or by crook, nobody can take that away from him. He wants that status.
I won't take it away from him. I'm just very disappointed in the
I mean, that'd be well if you're taking it away from him, but sure.
Yeah. You know what? Me and Asher have had a lot of matches in the past. And as much as I hate to admit it, Asher's got the better of me. He's had my number every single time. And that's kind of hard for me to accept. That's why, come the show, 1st of March, I'm rooting for both of you.
Well, this is
Ash kicking that you deserve.
I've been in the ring with Sebastian, I've been in the ring with Tom in singles matches. I came up short both times. I need my revenge on this as well.
Yeah.
I know, Kairn, that you're sick and tired of these guys like this coming into FCW and trying to rule the roost, run roughshod, take take liberties with, like, you know, the way that wrestling should be done. It shouldn't be this, like, pack a dog mentality of, like, killing each other to try and get, like,
yeah.
to get
somewhere in the company.
Yeah.
It should be about, you know, going out there and wrestling fairly, and as cheesy as it sounds, like, go out there and prove that you are better than the men that are in the ring across from
you. I completely agree. Yes. Like, I can give you an analysis of all three of these men. Sebastian Asher, he's doing it for status.
Yeah.
Tom Atlas, he wants it because he wants to latch onto something and be relevant. And Duke, well, this is the hardest one to say. Duke has got a lot of aggression that he denied. Like, he never
pent up aggression.
Yeah,
pent up aggression.
Like, he didn't release the ball.
He never released it. He fought in his head. Like, I have to.
He's reached snapping point.
He snapped, and I think with Duke, it's instead of, like, looking internally and going, like, maybe I need to let this go.
Yeah.
Like, I need to work on myself. No, he chose to take out on every other person.
Yes.
And unfortunately, Kim Williams was the man he chose to take out. And Yuji Maki.
Do you know who me and Kairn do it for?
Who's that? The mumps.
The mumps.
Exactly. Because we will always bring it back to them.
You know what?
It's not priority.
That is pretty disturbing, very scary, and I respect both of that,
yes,
to be quite honest. And you know what? I think the mumps are going to be for a great show.
Oh,
you guys get
well entertained.
Yes.
Well entertained.
There's titles, FCW,
yeah.
Mumps.
Yeah.
I think you guys are going to be rolling in nothing but bitches and bingo.
But hey, I mean, let's be honest, Kim. Why are we in the tag team division? We want those titles one day.
We do,
but
we do.
One thing that we know, it's... we need to earn a shot at them.
We do.
And our first step on that ladder is by
getting
a bit of payback on Sebastian and Tom.
As a man who...
Shutting the holes.
Yes.
Shut your hole, Tom.
Shut your hole, Tom.
Shut your hole, Sebastian. Sure.
I was going to say, we're obviously going to do our little Tom Atlas.
Oh, don't worry.
Yeah.
That's coming.
Yeah, we're going to re-Tom Atlas. As a man who unfortunately failed the first hurdle for those titles, it's a very hard thing to go and do. And
yeah.
You know what? It cost me my tag team to Spike, and I have no hostility towards Spike because look what he's done.
Yeah.
And but that being said, I think you guys can do it. I generally think you guys can take that next step up, and you know how that starts. Kicking their ass.
Day one, baby.
Day one. March 1st.
Yeah.
March 1st.
I've loved tag team wrestling my whole life. I've wanted to be a tag team champion when I got into wrestling. Couldn't think of a better partner to go and do it.
I appreciate that. I think I'm the same.
See, I'm looking forward to this. And to be honest, if there's ever a six man,
yeah,
give me a call, guys.
Yeah, exactly.
I'll get my bucket hat.
I'll get your shirt out. You need to learn how to slosh.
I'll learn how to slosh, guys.
Yeah.
Get your research done.
But
right. But yeah, like I said, we all like a laugh, but that night, as soon as that bell rings, business time for those Super Moms.
It's go time, guys.
Exactly.
Yeah. Like, I've wrestled.
They're going to regret picking a fight with.
Oh, yeah.
They're going to quickly realise they've made a mistake.
Absolutely.
So, yeah,
they've done it now.
Yeah.
They've gone and made a big mistake.
Yes. I'll be watching this one very closely, and quite honestly, I'm going to be very happy to see you two. You two. We are arms right there.
Good luck, Botchico.
Yep, that's
what's going to happen, man.
That's my take on the matter.
Thanks. Right, we've got a couple of title matches to close out
this
card. So we know what the main event is. We spoke about it earlier. So let's talk about Serena Rose versus Daisy Jenkins. We spoke about her about earlier. She is the hardest man in Fife.
So Patryk here from the future, although both these versions of myself are obviously in the past as you listen to this. We've had some bad news, unfortunately. Daisy Jenkins is now unable to compete in the SCW Women's Championship match on this show. But we've got an exciting replacement for her in the form of Ellie Armstrong, who makes a return to FCW. So yeah, disappointing that we can't see Daisy in action, but we're still going to keep the sort of chat about the match in the podcast, because there's some good stuff in there. But yeah, so this is just a reminder that the card is always subject to change, basically. So, but enjoy the rest of the show.
As we pointed out, she won that latest Fatal 5 Way.
Wouldn't she be the hardest person if I
did?
All
of the above.
No, the
hardest
the
wrestler.
Title is hardest man.
That's true. Yeah.
She's won it. She is the hardest man in
Becky fight. Lynch is the man. Daisy Jenkins is the hardest man in Fife.
Yeah, but wouldn't she be like the hardest man, woman, and other in Fife?
Yes.
No, she's just the hardest man in Fife.
Okay, she's the hardest.
Right, anyway, semantics aside.
No, semantics. That's facts.
Okay.
Semantics. Where does she
work? But yeah.
I say it every month on this podcast. Ken's obviously a new co-host now, so he's not maybe heard me go on about this in the length as much as other people have. I used to be the guy that would come in here every month and say, Serena Rose is cocky, she's this, she's that, she's going to get a comeuppance, she's going to slip up one day, and she doesn't. Yeah. And she just keeps winning. And she's still undefeated in FCW. This company's been around for over 4 years now, and she's still undefeated. But, to my knowledge, she's not wrestled Daisy Jenkins before.
No, no.
So, this is something new for her, so who knows?
I could have done with Daisy Jenkins at the First City Rumble, and it might have helped me out a wee bit.
Yeah.
I'm just going to throw my hands up here. I have a little bit of bias for Serena Rose.
Just a little bit.
Just a little bit.
Justified.
Would you guys agree? I had Dickie Divers on the ropes.
Literally.
Literally, we were on the ropes. Yeah. Serena Rose grabs my leg, I get distracted. Next thing I know, choked out, kicked in the back of the head. Yeah. So, it's... I find it hard to be unbiased here. And personally, I would be very happy to watch Daisy Jenkins kick Serena Rose's butt all over Tulloch.
Yeah.
But you know what? That being said, I've got my frustrations out. We can now just get on with it.
Yeah. Looking forward to it.
Yeah. What do you think? Do you think Daisy can do it?
I'm hoping Daisy can do it.
Yeah. The Divers clan needs... like
a great good kicking.
Yeah, they need to be humbled a bit.
Yeah,
and we know Divers isn't defending his title in this show, so
that makes me worried that he'll be kicking about somewhere.
Well, he will be. He'll be. Let's be honest. He's going to be at ringside.
Yeah, right.
Yeah. It's like we're, I'm not going to touch on our match again too much because we spoke about.
Yeah.
Ian Kerr know that Duke's going to be in the building somewhere. Whether he's out at the ring with them, he's looking about Tulloch somewhere waiting to strike. So we have no doubt. The same way that Daisy will be. Daisy will be fully planning for Dickie Divers to be
there. But Dickie Divers may be there. We're talking about that. There's one thing we're not considering here, and Sarah Rose may be preparing for that match, but also in the back of the head knows that Brody Adler's out there.
Absolutely,
yeah.
The briefcase of strike. The briefcase of Damocles, as I've been on.
The briefcase of Damocles, I like that.
It's good there.
Yeah. That must be sitting in her head.
There's not many Greek mythology references these days. I think it should be brought back.
Well, for all you Greek mythology fans out there.
Yeah, oh, yeah.
Here's everyone on this podcast.
I was going to say, we've had a letter from them. John himself.
John and Kate do not appreciate the joke.
Yeah, and they've drawn a picture of Medusa.
Oh no, don't look at it. Oh, Botchico's turned to stone, ladies and gentlemen.
Oh god, that Medusa, what a stiff worker.
Yes.
Bad stuff. But yes, back to the match.
We'll just kind of need to wait and see.
It's a toss-up as well, because like we were saying, Daisy's proved that she can, you know,
it's just the antics and the shenanigans that you said the Diver clan may pull out in this match. We just need to...
I'm going to get a wee dig in there while I've just remembered because of the arsehole that he's turned into. Do you know who Daisy Jenkins pins to become the hardest man in Fife?
Who?
Duke. So there you go. There you go, Duke.
You know what? Sometimes just desserts happen.
Yeah, you know what? At the time I felt quite sad, but now I'm like, nah, well, you know.
Ha ha.
Yeah, exactly.
I was going to say, like, does that mean she's also now the natural 20 Daisy Jenkins?
The natural 20 natural Daisy 20 Jenkins.
The natural hardest
man. Yeah, the natural hardest man.
Hardest 20 men in
the world. Yes! There we go.
All of that. Yeah, take that.
I was going to say, Duke, you can keep that one on record for yourself.
Yeah, exactly.
But should we move on?
Main event of the evening.
Ladies and gentlemen, it is now time for the Junior Heavyweight Title Match.
Hyped, lads.
So, we know where it is, Spike again.
Spike Tierney had this championship now for over a year against Main Event J. Robin.
Main Event J. Robin.
You?
I don't know, we've seen eye to eyes, but, you know, there's a lot riding on this.
Yeah.
There's a lot going on.
They've known each other for a long time, you know.
Yeah.
We've maybe not always seen it, like, on screen, but, you know, there's always... they've not always been on the same side of the fence on things, but there's been sort of mutual respect there over the years. They've kind of grown up in the business together.
Yeah.
This is a very poignant match. Yeah. I'm glad that it's getting the main event spotlight because, again, like I said, Spike's had this belt for over a year now, so it's almost like a reward for Spike to be in the main event slot, but also it's a reward for Jay for, like, similar to yourself, Botchico. for the hard work he's been putting down at Dundee Academy of Professional Wrestling to like get himself up to that level. Yeah. Where it isn't a gimmick. It's like, oh, go and have the main event, lads. You think it's nice? They have both earned it.
Yeah, well, Spike clearly sees that in him, and that's why he came out at Queen's after that match. Exactly. With Divers and offered him that match, because Divers wouldn't put his title on the line against that match. Which
funny that, funny, like the Valiant champion that we'll have. And I will bring it up again. He didn't show up for the podcast. Yes, but now he's a guy that doesn't show up for the podcast and doesn't put his championship on the line.
Shows up new,
this match is interesting to me because I think you both know this. I know both these men very well.
Like,
friends with both of them for a long time.
I've been friends, like, me and Jay Robin didn't see eye to eye for a long, long time. In fact, I'm sure you guys remember, me and him have had some clashes in the ring, quite a few actually. But when we started out, I'll give him his credit. He's one of the men who wanted me to come and train in Dundee.
Yeah.
And I'll give him his credit. Spike Tierney is my ex-tag team partner. Like, he's one of the men that stood by me. Yeah, we didn't have a great ending, but I think we won that trust back.
No.
And I've got nothing, I mean nothing, but like respect and actually admiration for what Spike did after we broke up. Mm. And this match, I don't know how to call this one. Like, God help Chris Quinn, our referee, because I could not call this one myself. Like,
big shout, by the way. Big Chris Quinn fan.
Oh, yeah, like, we all love Chris. We love Chris out here.
Yeah.
But Jay Robin, like, he went down a dark path for a long time.
He got led astray, he
fell in with a bad crowd.
He did.
The guys that like smoke cigarettes around the back of the bike sheds and that, you know.
The guys who definitely dealt firecrackers outside the Premier.
Yeah.
But you know what? I always knew it was there. I always saw it was there. And that's why I used to be so disapproving of him. Like, we used to see him do some horrible things and I've got a bit of bias. What he decided to take them out on me and Spike one day.
Yeah.
And that was when he joined the new paradigm. But thankfully, he stopped drinking the Kool-Aid. He let himself, think for himself like he always has. I guess he got blinded by the light for some reason. And you know what? I've been there with Ewan. Ewan's a very charismatic person, and it's easy to do. And the fact is, he broke himself away from it. And look what he's done. He's had a match with ADM, one of the best in the Scottish wrestling scene. Hell, he took, as you pointed out, Dickie Divers.
SWA great
He took him to the limit, and I think that's the only reason Dickie Divers never put the title on, because he was scared. He was scared that belt was
going to...
Yeah, exactly. He was scared he was going to lose that belt. And that's why I think G. Robin is the correct number one contender.
Mm.
Spike, on the other hand, let's talk about Spike.
What can you say about Spike Tierney that's not already been said?
I felt so bad how many times I let that man down.
No, you didn't let him down. Don't be saying that.
I let him down so many times that there's matches we had won. That's how good that man was. I'd like to say that man carried 70-30 of those matches. Yeah, I did my part, but you have to, like, put yourself aside for a second. Remember how good Spike is.
Oh, yeah.
That man can wrestle, like, the only champion that I can think of wrestled 3 times in one day and defended the title all 3 times. Like, he's a great champion. And he's taken on all comers.
Mm-hmm.
Look at the cavalcade of people he beat. He unseated our champion, Taylor Bryden.
Yeah.
He has beaten...
A who's who of junior heavyweights.
Yeah, exactly.
Go back and listen to the Christmas special if you want, like, the list, because myself and the commissioner go through it, and there's a reason that podcast is about 3 hours long. Half of it was probably going through Spike's defenses.
Well, I was going to say, the man also had his setback, and you know what he did after that setback?
Go back on the horse.
He got back on the horse,
yeah.
And he won every single match, and then won his title back. And he beat Sebastian Asher in a fantastic match.
Mm-hmm. I've seen that man getting beat.
Everyone loves seeing Sebastian Asher.
And you'll see it again on March the 1st.
Yeah. He's the only man, when he was born, his mother turned around and slapped his mother instead of him.
What have you done?
So,
such an asshole.
Shame with my thought.
But that's what I'm having to, like, bring up here. Like, there's a reason Spike is actually brought in. Like, you know, he helps train a lot of people.
Yeah.
Because that man's ability is just so good. That man can fly around the ring. It's the same as, you know, blowing a whistle. Mm-hmm. And that's how, that's why he is our
champion. That's how easy it is for him, just to do what he does.
That being said, J. Robin knows him well. And this
student of the game, J. Robin.
Very
is
student
one
of the
thing
game.
He will do will be studying every single one of Spike Tierney's defences.
Oh, he'll sit down and watch every single match, every single move, every single not even wrestling movement in the ring. Mm-hmm. And J. Robin, as much as we talked earlier about my like weirdly encyclopedic
knowledge
of
yeah.
wrestling, I only match mine to J. Robin. Mm-hmm. Me and him, even when we were feuding, would argue in the back about stupid details about who is the only WWF champion. Well, two. There was two of them.
Oh, here we go. Pop quiz, right?
Yeah. Who are the only two? Who are the only two WWF champions not fully acknowledged by the Federation? Are you going?
Antonio Inoki.
Antonio Inoki.
Andre the Giant.
Wrong.
No, Ted DiBiase.
Ted DiBiase.
Yeah.
Me and him would argue about stuff like that. That's how much a student of the game is. He doesn't go back. Like we see a lot of guys in their business. They'll remember WCW from the 90s. They'll remember WWF from the 90s. Maybe some ECW from the 90s. Early 2000s. Me and J. Robin would sit there and talk about world-class championship wrestling from the 1980s. We would talk about AWA from the 70s, NWA from the 50s. That's how much a student of the game this man is. And you know what? That might be something Spike has to watch out for. Because what could we see? J. Robin breaking out, you know, the move list of Kerry Von Erich.
Who knows, yeah.
Vern Gagne, maybe. Hey,
he'll know it. He'll know how to do it.
He might even bring out Stan Stasiak. Yeah. Or even Gorgeous George himself. I know I'm going on, I'm waffling about J. Robin here, but this is the things we have to remember. Like,
we have to remember as well, within what, the last half a year, the improvement from J.
It's
been very, very impressive.
We're there every week with him. Mm-hmm. We're seeing it for ourselves.
He's very impressive. So, Spike does need to keep a wee eye out.
Like, you can't take him out. I don't think Spike will, though. It's not in his nature to do that.
As a man that's tagged with Spike, he won't. He will be sitting down studying this as well.
Spike's probably thinking, I've beaten everyone else. I mean, he did take on Jay in a triple threat match back in the MLC. That was nearly a year ago now. Mm-hmm. And he's not faced this Jay Robin. He's thinking, I need to continue. If I want to continue my status as one of the best champions of Scotland, I need to keep defeating the best guys in this division.
Exactly.
And right now, one of the best guys in this division, if not the best contender, like you said, is J. Robin. Because he's been fighting guys outside this division. He's been fighting guys who've been going for the heavyweight championship.
Like, and he's been taken to the limit. Also, can we put a wee side note in there? And who else lost in that match? Duke Cannon.
He did!
Yes! We like a Duke Cannon loss.
Yeah.
And these are Duke facts that we're just going to talk
about.
This week on Duke Facts.
Yeah, we just have a little list of like when Duke kind of lost, like, and then like, you know, stuff like where it would be funny, or like when Duke had a stamp, you know, like you get coffee and you get like 5 stamps.
Yep.
Wouldn't it be funny? It's like we'll have one that's like Duke had 5 stamps, but it ran out.
He also lost to me in the kind of the class rumble after he tried to answer Rich Money's bounty. And just walked in and immediately went up to me and was like, sorry, Patryk. Like, don't care about my friendship with you. I just want the money.
Yeah, that was quite scary. Because somebody told me about this later. Because I found a lot of the stuff that happened there. By the way, congratulations on your retention.
Yes.
What's his name? Finding out Duke just how badly he's changed. The fact that he...
It's not nice.
You guys have been friends with him, and money just kind of... Yeah. That scares me.
$2.5 million will do a lot to people.
How much Lego can you buy for that?
We should have really worked that so we could have walked away with that money together.
I know.
We didn't think this through.
Yeah.
You guys have to remember one thing though. That means you have to be in league with Rich Money. You don't want to be in league with that.
Just till we get us the money, then we can go to the theme parks and that like we want to do.
Yeah. Next show's in April, right? Hopefully he doesn't listen to this, and we'll do it then. We've got a lot of fun.
You can just go off at Universal Studios for a wee week.
True, but you have to remember, then you'd have to click into it and read the description. I don't think you can read. Do you guys think you could read?
No.
Nah, I don't think so either.
I thought you meant me.
Botchico wouldn't say something like that.
Could we all just make fun of Rich? Just the fact that he tried to pay it off, and then... How long was he in the ring? A minute, and then you threw him out?
Yeah.
I mean, technically he was out from what? Third?
I know, yeah.
But in the ring, as you said, yeah.
Yeah, I think
he had about 20 seconds.
I think our referee lasted longer in the ring than he did.
Yeah. Good old Jamie Jones.
You know what? Anyway, you know what? I've gone off topic here. I apologise.
Bring it back, Botchico.
Let's bring it right back.
Like, who do you think is going to win?
Put your neck on the line.
Your
fellow wrestling nerd or your former tag team partner?
This is one of the toughest questions I've... Like, all these matches, I maybe had, like, you know, lads of inclination who I think would win, but this is the one that is generally 50-50. Like, we talked about Caleb Valhalla being in a tough situation. Yeah. See, if I got put as the referee for this match, I don't know if I could handle it. Like, right. I personally think, if I have to call it, I'm only calling this, and this is no respect, like, literally, if you ran this simulation 1,000 times, literally, the only difference would be a 501 to 499.
Mm-hmm.
And it's only because of experience and being around them. I am going to go by a slither. The skin of your teeth, Spike Tyranny.
Okay.
And that's the thing. The skin of your teeth, because all it takes is one misstep by Spike, and we've got a new junior heavyweight champion.
Caleb, what do you think? What about you?
I like going for the underdog. Yeah. I'm going with Jay.
Can I shock you? I agree with you.
I'm not.
I think there's something in the air.
You think there's something?
He's vastly made an improvement.
That's okay. Go. You get another rice. You don't have to have hot sauce on this.
He's vastly made an improvement. It's just shocked quite a few of us that we didn't see coming. And
I don't think it's probably shocked a lot of the Dab Dab guys because we see it.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
But what I mean
maybe the fans watching are like, who, like, Jay Robin, as the commissioner says, I maybe didn't have this on my bingo card.
Yeah.
That's what I was meaning. Like,
but, you know, like...
He's impressed quite a few,
like...
Pleasant surprise.
Yeah.
Like, he's definitely a wild card here, like...
He's been coming up short, he's had a bit of glorious failure, I think it's going to be like Scotland against Serbia now, and he'll hate that I've used them as a football reference, but I don't care. I think this is a penalty shooter that he's going to win and he's going to break through.
I can definitely get on board with that. Like, I'll stand by my prediction, but I don't disagree with your prediction, if that makes sense.
Yeah, absolutely. Again, flip a coin. Again, back to the cliche of SCW being, like, very 50-50, but that's one of the best things about Fair City Wrestling.
Mm-hmm.
Anyone could win any match.
Basically, this is... You know what? You know how improbable this is? And you'll like this reference.
Okay.
This is... The idea of, like, you know, the idea of Spike and Jay wrestling, and the idea of maybe Jay might come out on top, is France v Scotland.
Yeah.
Scotland 1-0 Hamden.
Yeah.
But
is Jay Robin Gary Caldwell?
Yeah, he is Gary Caldwell. I think they have a similar hairline.
Yeah.
But everyone says, "Oh, that was very improbable." Jay Robin, same to, "Oh, Jay Robin can't be the champion." But what happened the second time they played?
Yeah.
Exact same result.
So also James McFadden.
Exactly. So that's my point, is the fact is that everyone says, oh, maybe Jay Robin can do it. We don't really know about him, but Scotland just did that twice.
Yeah.
That's a really good example. You know what? I'm going to change it down. I'm still sticking with Spike management, but it's not 199 to 501. It is now, 499.5.
Oof.
To 500.5.
Wow.
That's how close this is.
Cool.
I unfortunately can't bet too much against Spike. It's too bad. Look, this is the one, if you had an accumulator, you wouldn't pick.
No.
Because
this is the one that I think you should get on and buy a ticket.
How do you know who's going to win this match? You've got to be there. You've got to be there to see it.
Like, let's put it this way. I want to buy a ticket to see this match, and I'm allowed to come in.
We're going to get you as part of your fee for the podcast. We're going to get you a good seat.
Like I said, you guys are booked on the card. You'd buy tickets to watch this.
Exactly. I mean, we're going to wrap things up now there because we've been getting through things. But again, what a card for £5.
God, tell me.
Main card, Fair City Wrestling Empire Show.
And that's us not... Like saying that because that's us just being genuine. Like you take us off.
Ah.
What a still a fantastic card you got there.
Like you said, to use Spike as an example here, that £5 doesn't even cover his kebab.
Exactly.
Yeah,
because that boy gets a big kebab.
He gets a big kebab, and that's the thing. £5 doesn't even get you that size of kebab, but it gets you some of the greatest wrestling
We're being good to you this month, guys.
Yeah.
Get yourself down to the Tulloch Institute. I remember seeing on our socials the other day. We think we're already at half capacity. Tickets have been signed.
Yeah,
but you know, don't wait, don't turn up on the day. Well, two reasons don't turn up on the day. A, because you'll be paying more than double the price. And B, you might not get in.
Yeah.
So get your ticket online. Get your ticket online early and make sure that you get yourself down to Tulloch.
Exactly. Like, don't just sit at the bar at the Tulloch Institute going, oh, maybe we'll just go maybe through later. Get your tickets now.
Because if you don't, I think somebody else will.
Yeah.
It's an age-old question.
I mean, the fact that you're there, there's going to be more mums there.
Who doesn't want to see this shaking about?
Is why I've asked my mum not to be there. I love you guys and all, but...
Mama Botch.
Mrs. Botch not going to be there?
I've met Senor Botch at the football, but I've not met Mama Botch yet.
No. Like, as much as I would happily call one of you guys dad...
Well, it's funny you mentioned this, right? Again, exclusive on the podcast before we do wrap things up. I've found out something quite funny.
What is that?
Young prodigy here at Dundee Academy of Pro Wrestling. Saw him at the showcase at Queen's Hotel. Pretty boy Sam McMillan.
Wow,
the one that booted me out of the room.
Yeah, I know. I know it was
Duke's fault, but still.
I was getting beaten up in the other corner at the time. I couldn't help you. I'm sorry about that.
No, I'm not blaming you.
Yeah, okay. I just wanted to put that on the record. A little buddy's told me that pretty boy's mum might have a little thing for a big boy. Kairn, Patryk and Kairn might have to start looking after Sam because I might be getting
a new adopted son.
Yeah, exactly. And on that note,
think about it this way, you could do worse than an adopted son for one reason only. You know what that is?
What's that?
He was another one that lasted longer than Duke in the wrong place.
And on that note, ladies and gentlemen, thank you for listening to this edition of the FCW podcast. Our guest has been Botchico.
It's been a pleasure, guys.
My new co-host on the podcast, Kairn Douglas. I am the king of the class, Patryk Pateski. Don't forget to get your tickets on fairsitywrestling.com.
And ticketsource.co.uk.
For the sum of £5. Right, so who else has Duke Cannon lost to in the last year? Let's keep going through it.
Well, I think there's the Michelin Man, there was the Honey Monster.
Yeah. The Stay Puft Man.
Yeah, Stay Puft. What's the name? The Noid, he ruins pizzas, by the way.
Papa Smurf as well, did you know?
Yeah, definitely lost to Papa Smurf. Did he not lose to Doom Guy from the game?
Anyone that was in that rumble.
I definitely lost that minion.
Remember he dressed up as that Chinese anime character?
I'm sure he tapped out to David Cameron as well.